Thank you.
The Gemara says in Masechtas Chagiga that Arba nichnasu lapardes. There are four people who entered what's called the pardes, the deepest secrets of the Torah. And of the four, only one emerged unscathed, and that was Rabbi Akiva. One person died. One person went crazy. One person became an apikurus. Rabbi Akiva, however, the Gemara says, "Nichnas b'shalom v'yatza b'shalom." He went in peace, and he emerged. He emerged b'shalom. He emerged in peace also. You hear me in the back?
Yeah.
So on several occasions, the Rebbe pointed out, why is it important nichnas b'shalom, that he went in peace? The main thing is, they should say, Rebbe Akiva yatza b'shalom, he went out. The Rebbe says the reason why he went out in peace is because he went in differently than everyone else. Because he was nichnas b'shalom, therefore he was yatza b'shalom. When he went in, he knew exactly what he was going for. He knew his plan was to emerge, and it wasn't just to drink in and to quench his thirst, but he knew that there was, with the secrets of the Torah, but he knew the goal was ultimately to come out and to have an impact on the world and Torah mitzvahs. So because when he went in with the right intentions, so therefore when Yatza, he also was able to go out with the right intentions. As opposed to the others, when they went in, they didn't have the same strength and resolve when they went in, and that's why they didn't make it out in the proper way. And the Hira, the lesson, one of the lessons from this is that things in life don't happen by mistake. When we come out of a certain experience in a certain way, it's usually because we entered that experience with that expectation and with that the hope and with the effort and the decision and the determination that we're going to leave that experience with that result, with that effect. And that's definitely very true by Fabrengen. We're sitting here by Chassidus Fabrengen. to commemorate the birthdays of the Shtei Ma'iris HaGedolim, the Baal Shem Tov and the Alter Rebbe. And also, we're going to talk a little about preparing for Rosh Hashanah, as much as the time allows. And by Fabrengen, we could definitely say that if there's a Nichnas B'Shalom, then there will be a Yatzah B'Shalom. In other words, a Fabrengen has a purpose. There's a reason why we sit by a Fabrengen. And it's not just intellectual curiosity, or with the hope that we'll hear a few good stories, or we'll hear a nice and interesting idea. Hopefully all of these taka will happen, and a Fabrengen does usually include those components also. But that's not the purpose of a Fabrengen. The purpose of a Fabrengen is to come out somewhat different than how we walked in. To be moved, to be touched, to be inspired, so that tomorrow is not like today was. Otherwise, so we heard a story, we gained a little information, but it didn't have any meaningful change, it didn't make any meaningful change in our life. We may as well have been sitting and learning Gemara. And Fabrengen is about, it's really group therapy. That's really what a Fabrengen is. What is group therapy? Group therapy is a bunch of people. You have one-on-one therapy. One-on-one therapy is when you go to a mashpia. You go to your mentor, and you talk to him about your problems, and he tells you the solutions. The problem with a mashpia, a lot of times, is that he's living in a different world than you. Not necessarily can he relate to the issues that you're relating to. And then a group therapy is when you have a bunch of people sitting together, all of them suffer the same problem. To one degree or another, some people are a little more past it, some people are a little less past it, and they can all share their experiences and their tips, and there's a certain camaraderie and kinship amongst people who realize that they have the same challenges in life. And that's really what a Fabrengen is all about. We all suffer from the same disease, and the disease is called the Yetzer Hara, the Nefesh HaBehemes. It makes our life miserable. We want to be one way, but we're not successful necessarily in being the people that we want to be because we have the Yetzer Hara. And once in a while we gather together, we take a l'chaim, it lowers a little the inhibitions, and makes us a little more warm and a little more approachable, a little more penetrable, if that's a word. And we talk about this problem. We want to serve the Eibishter. We have an Nefesh HaLakis. We want to serve the Eibishter, but it's not so easy. The word Fabrengen really means a guy. In Yiddish, how do you translate it into English? The word Fabrengen. It's a gathering, but we sit and we talk. And when we go into Fabrengen with that approach, that I'm coming here because I want to be a different person tomorrow, then the chances are that that's going to happen. Chances are that in the Fabrengen, in the half hour, 45 minutes, hour and a half, 2 hours that we're sitting over here, however long it is, or 8 hours, whatever it turns out to be, something that is said, and if it's not something that is said, maybe a song that is sung, but something that by the Fabrengen, a part of the experience will touch our hearts and will get us to the place where we want to go. But that's only if we're coming into the Fabrengen in the first place, knowing where we want to go. If, however, we're not Nichnas B'Shalom, if we're coming to Fabrengen, we want to say Mitzvah Sanashim Ulamada because that's what's done. Okay, it's Chayal, we'll come to Fabrengen. Then is it possible that tomorrow will be different than today? It's possible. It's possible that something that is said is going to enter your heart and inspire you so, but the likelihood, the odds of that happening decrease greatly. So the first thing by Fabrengen is I think we should take another moment and we should sing another Chassidus Shenigin. And we should all think about what we're trying to get out of this Fabrengen. And as mentioned, if we do that, and if we enter Fabrengen Taka in a serious way, the chances are that we will get out of the Fabrengen that which we want. So let's say L'chaim maybe, and sing another Nigam. L'chaim, L'chaim L'vracham.
L'chaim Shalom.
Amen. Maybe let's sing a song from the Alter Rebbe. Kei Aliyatam Elei Kayarei Memeka Kei Aliyatam Yoyedek Oh yeah, Kaliyata viyadaka loyekai arimenaka kaliyata viyadaka So as mentioned, we're here tonight lechavid the Yom Huladas, the birthday of the Baal Shem Tov on Chai Yavel in the year Taf Nun Ches, in the year 1698. And the Alter Rebbe was born 47 years later on Chai Yavel in the year 1745. The Baal Shem Tov was the one who was miyasid. He founded, he instituted Chassidus, the Chassidic movement in general. And the Alter Rebbe, a few decades later, he was miyasid, he founded Chassidus Chabad. What is the difference between Chassidus and Chassidus Chabad? So while there are many differences, tonight I would like to focus on one difference. In other words, the Baal Shem Tov was trying to accomplish one thing, and the Alter Rebbe, building upon what the Baal Shem Tov was megala, what the Baal Shem Tov revealed, the Alter Rebbe built upon that and took it a step further, which obviously in the times of the Baal Shem Tov, that step wasn't ready yet to be taken. The Baal Shem Tov took the first step, the Alter Rebbe took it a step further. And this expresses itself in many differences, but tonight we'll talk about one difference. And it's like DNA. And every single detail, the whole thing is there. In other words, really we can examine every single difference and find the whole thing in there. Just like you take one hair from a person today, we know that the genome is found in every single cell. So the same thing also, the same is true in Torah. In every detail, in every prat, the whole klal is over there. And I want to focus tonight on miracles. We know that the Baal Shem Tov is synonymous with miracles. It's not that the Baal Shem Tov did miracles. That was one of the things he did. But it's almost as if that when we hear the name Baal Shem Tov, we're like, okay, what story are you going to tell me? The Baal Shem Tov was known, we have Hosfarim Shivchi Baal Shem Tov. Baal Shem Tov was known for the many miracles that he did. And it's not only the quantity of miracles, but also the quality. So it's not only Kamos, but also an Echos. There are miracles and there are miracles. And when you hear like a really mind-blowing miracle, you say that's a Baal Shemsky miracle. That's a miracle of the Baal Shem Tov's ilk, of the Baal Shem Tov's type. Because the Baal Shem Tov wasn't about the quantity, the amount of miracles that he did, But the nisim that he did also were completely teva, nature just didn't play any role by the Baal Shem Tov. I mean, you know, the standard story of the Baal Shem Tov begins with, you know, that after Shabbos he gathers all the students into the wagon and he tells the wagon driver, the goy, Alexi, turn around. And the next thing you know, a few hours later, they're a place 1,000 miles away somewhere in a city, in a place in Romania or somewhere. In other words, the miracles that he did had no achiza whatsoever, had no... they were completely supernatural. You know, there are different kinds of miracles, different types of miracles. One type of miracle is that something happens which is extremely, extremely unlikely. In the Six-Day War is that kind of miracle. What are the chances, the odds of a country going and defeating however many nations were attacking it within 6 days? But at the same time also was a nas, which it had an achiza and teva. In other words, we can look back and we can analyze it and see how it happened. That doesn't make it less of a miracle. But it wasn't as if, like Avraham Avinu, when he was taking the sand and throwing it and turning into arrows. That's a Baal Shem Tov type miracle. A miracle which has no place whatsoever in Teva. The Alter Rebbe, on the other hand, miracles wasn't his thing. It's not to say he never. There are no miracle stories. There are no nisim which the Alter Rebbe did. But that's not what the Alter Rebbe is renowned for. And in general, those who are familiar with Chassidus Chabad know that throughout the generations in Chabad, miracles were never, even the miracles that there were, weren't spoken about so much. Miracles wasn't a big deal. It wasn't a big deal wasn't made out of them. And also we don't find in quantity or in quality the types of miracles by the Alter Rebbe as we did by the Baal Shem Tov. You know, Yutes Kislev is the Rosh Hashanah for Hasidus, and by Chassidus Chabad, and it celebrates the liberation of the Alter Rebbe from prison, from Tsarist prison. The story is told that after the Alter Rebbe was released, at a certain point in time, he bumped into his mechutn, I believe, Yitzhak of Berdichev. The Alter Rebbe and Rebbe Levi Yitzchak were related. The Alter Rebbe's granddaughter got married to Rebbe Levi Yitzchak's grandson, or perhaps vice versa. It was I don't remember which one it was. And Rebbe Levi Yitzchak turns to Alter Rebbe and he tells the Alter Rebbe Mechutn, so I don't understand why you had to go through all that pain and suffering and aggravation and anguish. He said, you could have just put your hand over your forehead and burnt up the whole St. Petersburg with makifim. Makifim is a Kabbalistic term which means divine energies which transcend and are beyond the world. They're makif. They surround the world. They're beyond and above. And Dr. Rebbe responded, he said to his mechutn, he says, that's not my way of operating. I don't do that stuff. Rabbi Yitzchak was saying was true, the Alter Rebbe could have done that. The Alter Rebbe says that's not my style. And instead it's kind of anticlimactic, you think, that this big Yom Tov which we celebrate in Lubavitch every single year on Yutes Kislev celebrates a liberation from prison. But how did that liberation happen? Basically, the Alter Rebbe was a very smart person and he convinced the ministers and the interrogators that he was innocent and they let him free. Now that's a miracle.
Biggest miracle.
Well, it's the guy. You'd think that if you want to start off your Chassidic movement with a bang, you know, you say a few names of the Eberster and the walls of the prison fall down, and all the people who are against you drop dead. Then you ride your horse back to Lyozhna, wherever it is. It's kind of like I said, it's anticlimactic. What would the Baal Shem Tov have said about that? We're not here to measure people who's greater, who's who can make better miracles and bigger miracles. The story is told, there's a Siddiq Rebbe, his name was Rameir of Premishlan. And he was known as an incredible Baal Mitzvah. He used to do miracles. And an incredible Baal Ruach HaKodesh. He knew everything that was going on. So he had a chassid that once came to him. Obviously this chassid was a little of a mechutzef. And he said to him, Rebbe, I don't understand. He says, your Ruach HaKodesh far surpasses those of the other Rebbes who live in our generation. And everyone knows those other Rebbes are greater than you are, the Ruzhiner and others. How is it that you have so much Ruach HaKodesh when you're not such a big Rebbe? So he answered, whenever he spoke about himself, he spoke in, he talked about Meirel. So I'll tell you the truth. He says every night Meirel goes to sleep and his neshama goes up to heaven. Now in heaven, every single big tzaddik has a palace prepared for him. And when his neshama, when he goes to sleep at night, the neshama goes into the palace. And over there, in that palace, they show the neshama everything that's going to happen on the next day or the next while that he needs to know. They give him all the information that's necessary, I guess, that all his chassidim are going to come to him, whatever he needs. But Meirel wasn't a big enough tzaddik to have his own palace. That's what he says. So he goes up, and he sneaks into one palace. And until they realize that he's not supposed to be there, and they kick him out. Finally, he sees everything that they're showing that tzaddik. They kick him out. He goes into the next palace, so he gets to see that they're showing the next tzaddik. Until they kick him out. And Devaylu, throughout the night, he gets to go and see what all the other tzaddikim combined are being shown for the following day. It's a story I heard, whether it's true, whether it's not true, but al-Kapanim. What it does tell us is that you can't judge a tzaddik by miracles, Ruach HaKodesh, who are people like us, Bechal, to make these evaluations. But we do see that, in Chassidus Chabad, miracles, it wasn't the style. Not in quantity, not in quality, and again, even those miracles that were done, they were brushed under the table. The Tzemach Tzedek's wife, Rebbe Simchaya Mushka, so she once said that by my father, the Mittler Rebbe, the second Lubavitcher Rebbe, the miracles were, gewalgit unter den Tisch, miracles were rolling around under the table, but no one bothered to pick them up. The miracles weren't something which was considered a big chiddush. And again, this seems to be a small thing. Is this really going to give us the depth of what Chassidus Chabad or Chassidus is about? But as we'll see again, in this small thing lies the essence of what the Baal Shem Tov is and the essence of what the Alter Rebbe is. Miracles are very nice, but miracles also, there's a problem with miracles. And to illustrate the problem with miracles, I'll tell you two stories. First story I heard from my mother, who heard this story from a Holocaust survivor, the person who this story happened to. This was in pre-war Poland, and this guy was from a frum family, but he went what they call today, went off the derech, and he abandoned frumkeit. I don't know if he completely abandoned it. I don't know whether it was just in public, or just in private or in public. And he had a friend who also, together with him, again, a formerly frum person. This was something which unfortunately was very common in Poland in pre-war. So he says he was with this friend. It was one Friday night, and they wanted to go have a cigarette. But in the shtetl, where all the Yidden are, you don't do it right there. So they went right outside the town. They walked out of town. They pull out, they each pull out a cigarette, and they realize they forgot the matches. They didn't have a light. But this is at the edge of town. So what's at the edge of town? It's a Beit HaKvar, so the cemetery is there. And in the cemetery was buried a tzaddik, a rebbe. I don't recall which rebbe. It wasn't one of the very famous rebbes that everyone would recognize the name anyways. A rebbe. And next to the kever, there are candles. So the friend says, there's fire there. The guy says, listen, I'm not so firm, but I'm not doing that. Not doing that. The friend obviously wasn't fazed. He went over. He bent over to light the cigarette, and on the spot he dropped dead. On the spot. Bending over the caver, he died. So this is the story that this person told my mother. It's 10 years ago, 15 years ago. So my mother asked him, so what happened afterwards? So he said, so I found other places worth to smoke on Shabbos. Another story, I heard this from someone in Crown Heights. His name is Yosef Yitzhak Butman. Actually, now he's already a shliach in Westchester. He told me the story a few years ago. He told me right after it happened. This Yosef Yitzhak Butman, he has a brother. His name is Velvel Butman, and he's the head shliach in Westchester. And one of the things that he does in Westchester, in his capacity as shliach over there, is that he likes to put, he puts up menorahs in public places. And in malls, he finds different malls around Westchester, and he tries to put up big menorahs over there. So a few years ago, he found out that there's a mall in very, very northern Westchester, which he hadn't reached out to yet. The more north you go, the less Yidden there are in Westchester. So he calls up the mall, and he introduces himself. My name is Rabbi Butman, calling from Chabad. I'd like to put a menorah. So he's something religious, yeah? Well, you have to speak to, there's a guy who he's in charge of all the religious events that happen in the mall. His name is Mr. Katz. Here's his number. Give him a call. Okay. Mr. Katz. Sometimes you call him, you don't know whether to be happier or less happy, you know. So he calls up this Mr. Katz. And he introduced himself. My name is Rabbi Butman, and I'm calling from Chabad. And the guy cuts him off and says, Chabad, 770 Eastern Parkway from Rabbi Schneerson? He says, yeah. He says, you know what? You got to come to me. I have a story to tell you. So this Velvel Butman calls up his brother Yosef Yitzchak and says, I think this is something of interest we're going to hear. Why don't you come with me? So they both went together to this guy, to this Mr. Katz in northern Westchester, and they heard this story from him. And I heard this from Yosef Butman, who heard this from this Mr. Katz. This is back in the 60s, and this Mr. Katz had a friend. And his friend had a child, a young child, I don't remember whether it was a son or a daughter, that had a very serious illness. And after multiple doctors and experts, they went to the top experts were in Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, and all the top experts decided that the child needs surgery. The only way for this child to have any hope for the future is through surgery. This guy bumped into someone and told him, your child's having a surgery, it's a tricky surgery, why don't you go and get a bracha from the rebbe? So Mr. Katz says, this is my friend. He went, he arranged an appointment to go to the Rebbe, and he asked me if I want to come along. It intrigued me, the Rebbe. Obviously, this guy wasn't religious or anything. He said, sure. So he made for himself also appointment by the Rebbe, right after, in other words, that he had a 2-minute appointment, 3 minutes, and then he was going to go in right after his friend. The only time that they were able to get appointment was the night before the surgery. So he had to leave 6 o'clock in the morning, he had to be on the train to Baltimore, together with his child. And he was able to get an appointment with Rabbi Yechidus for 11 o'clock the night beforehand. So Mr. Katz says, we come to 7:70, we arrive there at 10:30, me and my friend. Our meeting, the Yechidus is going to be at 11 o'clock. It's 11 o'clock, it's 12 o'clock, it's 1 o'clock, it's 2 o'clock. And my friend is going crazy. He has to be on the train. He has to go back to Westchester, get his kid, go on the train. 2:30 in the morning, it finally comes my friend's turn. He goes in. Less than 2 minutes later, he comes out. He slams the door behind him, and he walks off. I don't have a choice. I have to go in. It's my turn now to go into the Rebbe. I didn't have a chance even, so I went right away. I went into the Rebbe, spoke for 2-3 minutes. I asked for a bracha, some advice, certain things. And when I walk out, my friend is gone already. Apparently, he was in such a hurry that he himself went back to Westchester. I had to find my way back. A few days later, I finally get in contact with my friend and I asked him what happened. He says, I went into the Rebbe and I introduced myself. Told him why I'm here, told him my child's condition, and asked for a bracha. The Rebbe looks at me and says, your child doesn't need an operation. I was a little surprised by this answer. So I told the Rebbe, I understand that might be your opinion, but all the experts that we consulted think that this is the way to go, and I would be very happy if the Rebbe can give a blessing. The Rebbe says, I hear, but your child doesn't need an operation. So, this guy's already very nervous. In other words, he's sitting waiting until 2:30 in the morning. He's not in a very good mood. He's like, Rebbe, I didn't come here for medical advice. You're not a doctor. You're a rabbi. Just give me a blessing. And the Rebbe's being obstinate. Your child doesn't need an operation, the Rebbe says. Again. So I couldn't take anymore. I walked out. I ran out, slammed the door. Got to Baltimore the next day, and surprise, surprise, they do some pre-operation tests, and the child doesn't need an operation. This story happened in the 60s. So Rabbi Butman asks him, you ever went back afterwards to 770? No. That was his one and only time that he was in 770. What do both of these stories tell us? The common denominator in both of these stories is that you had people who were touched by miracles. Not necessarily in a positive way, the first one was a negative way, but 50, 60 years later, he's telling over the story, meaning that it had an impact, it would seem, on the person, right? That he realized that the hand of Hashem was there. The same thing is also with the other person. And yet, it didn't have a meaningful impact on these people's lives. And actually, it's in a way, it's the story of our history, right? How many times do you look at the Yidden, the stories in the Torah, the Yidden, they go out in the Mitzrayim, they have the 10 Makkos and all the miracles that they experience, and they can't stop complaining and nudging and we always think to ourselves, if only we would see such miracles, right? We'd be so different, we'd be changed, we would never do That's not the case. And the reason is because for substantive change to happen, it has to come from within. It can't come from without. And a miracle, as great and incredible and lofty and inspiring it might be, at the moment, is not something that comes from within. It is something that is forced upon us from without. And if you think into really what the dynamic of a miracle is all about, what is a miracle? When do we need a miracle? In a more philosophical sense, a miracle signifies that there's something wrong. When do we ask for miracles? When we go to work in the morning and everything's fine and everything's good and the health is good and the parnassah is good and everything's fine, is that when we're asking for miracles? No, then we're fine. When do we need a miracle? When there is something wrong. And what is the purpose of the miracle? Is when nature isn't working the way it's supposed to. When the natural order isn't working the way it's supposed to, so we say, we are going to bring in an override. That's what a miracle is. It's an override. It's an override button. Nature isn't working the way it's supposed to, we'll bring in the miracle. If nature is working the way it's supposed to, you don't need to have a miracle. So the definition of a miracle is something which is an external fix. It's an override. That is what a miracle is. And that is also the impact that a miracle has on us, is that it's an override. It's not something that comes from within. It's not essentially fixing the issue. When the Baal Shem Tov arrived on the scene of Jewish history, so we know the tradition is the Baal Shem Tov's name was Yisrael. Yisrael was the name of Klal Yisrael. At that time, the Yidden, morale-wise, were in the dumps. Spiritually, materially, they just experienced some 50 years earlier the terrible Khmelnytsky pogroms, which killed, they say, hundreds of thousands of Yidden in Eastern Europe at the time. There was also, and the aftermath of the Shamsi Tzvi debacle, which was a real downer. Many Yidden had gotten their hopes up very high. And when he turned out to be who he was, it left the Yidden in a swoon, in a spiritual faint. And the Baal Shem Tov, the name Yisrael, it says that when someone faints, you go and you whisper his name in his ear. And that draws the neshama back out. The neshama that's, when a person is in a state of a faint, the neshama is hidden. The Baal Shem Tov is whispering the name Yisrael, to call Yisrael, and awakening them up from their faint. And how did he do that? The Yidden at that time, again, we're saying they were in a state of faint. When a person has fainted, you have a guf. The body is intact. But the neshama, it's there, the person is still alive. But the soul is not, it's not evident. I would say it's withdrawn into its source. And the job of the Baal Shem Tov was to reveal the neshama bayin. To put it in somewhat different words, everything has a guf and a neshama. Everything has a body and a soul. Person has a guf and a neshama. The world has a guf and a neshama. every action has a guf and a neshama. Right? There's the body of the action. And then there's the intent, the purpose, the reason. That's the neshama of the action. Every mitzvah has a guf and a neshama. The Torah has a guf and a neshama. And the Baal Shem Tov was there to reveal the neshama in every single one of these dimensions. And that, in other words, Yiddishkeit in the times of the Baal Shem Tov was reduced to a guf state, to a body state. People were going through the motions. They were learning Torah, they were doing mitzvahs, but the neshama, the life, the vitality, the love, and the passion, and the enthusiasm, all that was missing. The Yidden, that's why they were compared to a state of being in a state of fainting. And what the Baal Shem Tov had to do, first and foremost, was bring the neshama back. And miracles was a very big part of how he did that. A miracle is a gili alakus. It's a revelation of godliness. It got people's attention. And that went hand in hand with so many of the other teachings of the Baal Shem Tov, all of which are connected to neshama. Whether it's Hashgacha Pratis, which has to do with the neshama of the world. Whether it's davening, which is all about neshama. Whether it's Simcha, which is about neshama. Avos Yisrael, which is about connecting to people on a neshama level. Everything out there that the Baal Shem Tov was doing was on the level of neshama, but it was, in a way, in the terminology of Chassidus, it was Melmaila Lamata. It was, yeah, in a way, it was an override. It was the Baal Shem Tov being Megala, holiness and Kedusha, and Elokus, and miracles, and thereby attracting so many Chassidim and so many neshamas. That was the avodah of the Baal Shem Tov. But by the Baal Shem Tov, again, the key over here is, for those of you who have learned Chassidus perhaps, the words Yisairusa de la'ela might ring a bell by you. It's an awakening from the above. It's a miracle. It's an override. It was the Baal Shem Tov going, and it's almost like Yitzias Mitzrayim, which is really what happened by Yitzias Mitzrayim, with all the miracles which drew the Yidden out of the Egypt that they were in at that time. And that was a necessary, that was the first step. The first step in the neshama, and revealing the neshama. See, this is about everything being with neshama. The first step is revealing the neshama. And then came along Act 2, which was the Alter Rebbe. And the Alter Rebbe wasn't into the miracles, because the Alter Rebbe was in the next step, which is what we call Avodah B'Koyach Atzmoy. Our own work, our own Aveda, changing things not from top down, but from bottom up. And miracles don't change things from bottom up. They don't. In fact, when the Alter Rebbe, we're put here in the world to change the world on its terms. Not by overriding the world, but by changing the world on its terms. Changing ourselves on our terms. You know, there are two ways that we can change. Let's put this in personal terms. There are two ways to bring about change within a person. One way is through inspiring the person. What is the definition of inspiration? Sorry? It never lasts. Why doesn't it last, inspiration? So it's a roller coaster, absolutely. And the only way it lasts is if you constantly pump it, right? You know, you're constantly feeding inspiration. Because if you take away the inspiration, why is that? Because by definition, inspiration is not about who I am. It's not about where I am in my level in Avodas Hashem. It's there's me. There's me and my desires and my perspectives and my issues. And I'm not dealing with them. Instead, when I'm inspired, I can overlook all that and act based upon my inspiration. And that's really what the Baal Shem Tov is about. And that's really where miracles come in, because miracles is the same idea. Miracles is about inspiration. And by the way, it's very effective. As long as you get the daily injection, inspiration can be very effective. I'm not saying it's not effective. And that's where the role of a tzaddik comes into play. A tzaddik is giving constant inspiration. The Torahs of the tzaddik, which are very inspiring, can keep a person going for 120 years. But even if you're going 120 years and serving Hashem with passion and with love and with fear because of inspiration, at the end of the day, is it really you? Or not? And the ultimate tachlis hakavana, the point in the creation of the world, is that it should be on your terms, not something which is overriding who you are and what you are and what your feelings are and what you think. But it should be because of who you are and part of who you are. The Alter Rebbe had a chassid. His name was Reb Shmuel Munkis. Ever heard of him, anyone? No? Better known as a little of a comedian. He was a very holy person, but in his own way, he had his own derech, and that was by doing things which other people looked at as shtick. And his fellow chassidim were used to his antics. They were used to that he would do things in a fight, but everything had a lesson, everything had a point. They're once walking home from a Fabringen, and they passed the Alter Rebbe. It was a Fabringen of chassidim, and they passed the house of the Alter Rebbe. And when they passed the house, Rebbe Shmuel Munkis gives a jump onto the fence. And he's hanging from the fence. I don't know, with his feet, with his hands. He's hanging from the fence. His friends look at him. They're like, okay, what now? What's this all about? So he said, as you go by, or the Rebbe said over the story. As you go by, a shoemaker. So hanging in the window is a shoe. You go by a tailor, so there's a piece of cloth hanging. You go by a glazier. There's a piece of glass hanging. You go by the Rebbe's house, there should be a chassid hanging there. Very cute, right? But there's amazing depth there. The shoemaker hangs up the shoe. The tailor hangs up the cloth. The Rebbe doesn't hang up the chassid. The chassid has to go and jump up and hang himself up. Avodah b'koyach atzmei, especially in Chassidus Chabad, means it's not going to happen through inspiration. It's not going to happen by you being blown away. It has to be real. It has to be real and has to be part of you. And that's real. That's a lot of work. It's a lot of work. But that's what Chassidus Chabad is all about. That's stage two. And stage one, and always in life, it always works. We start with an override, and then you get to, and then you deal with the issue in a more substantive and essential way. What is Chassidus Chabad? Chassidus Chabad means we learn. It's a philosophy. Chassidus Chabad is a philosophy. It's a perspective. It's a way of understanding things. It's a way of looking at things. It's not about a short vart. You know, we all enjoy a nice five-line vart that we can repeat by the Shabbos table, right? They're worth their weight in gold, right? And we enjoy them. You hear that? Ah, wow. So it says that word in that parsha, and that means that. Beautiful. But that's not a philosophy. That's inspiration. That's beautiful. And it's easier. But philosophy means, when the Alter Rebbe wrote 12 chapters in Tanya, explaining what does it mean Hashem Echad? What does it mean Hashem? What does it mean that Hashem is the only one? Hashem Echad means, not that there's one Hashem, but that everything's Hashem. Really? What does that mean that everything's Hashem? This is Hashem, this is Hashem. So, what's the answer to that? Yeah, of course. Does that make sense to you? So, Alter Rebbe devotes 12 dense chapters, which have to be studied with Alter Rebbe. And when you study it once, and you study it a second time, you think about it, it's not that you're being inspired. Your mind starts thinking in a certain direction. Chabad, the mind, leads to the heart. When I understand something, that impacts my emotions. when I understand how great Hashem is, not just when I hear beautiful words, but when I really understand it, when I come to love Hashem, I come to revere Hashem, and then when my mind and my heart are on board, then the machshava, dibur, ma'aseh, the thought, speech, and action are the natural consequence. It's work. But at the end of the day, what you have at the end of the day is a person who bottom up from on their own terms, from their own perspective, is connected to Hashem. The mind is connected. You've eliminated the resistance. There is no resistance over there. The path of inspiration, the path of miracles, it covers up the resistance. It doesn't eliminate the resistance. It covers it up. And that's why the moment the inspiration goes away, the resistance crops up again. So if in my heart, if the resistance is there, if I don't really understand it and I don't really feel it, but it's something which is being impressed on me constantly, then it's not something which has taken me through. And again, one issue is the issue of permanence, how long it's going to last. But even if theoretically inspiration could last me for 120 years, it's not me. It's someone operating through me. It's not me. You know, if I'm going to Tzaddik every day or every Shabbos and I'm going to the Tish and I'm being inspired and I'm behaving, so it could be said in a way, it's not me. I'm the Tzaddik's golem. I'm the golem of the Tzaddik. I'm just I'm the hands and feet of the Tzaddik. And I'm supposed to be me also. The Abishter created me because he wants me. He wants my mind. He wants my heart. You know, this is a basic difference between Yetzias Mitzrayim and when Mashiach comes. By Yetzias Mitzrayim, there was evil, there was Mitzrayim, and the miracles were sent to subdue the evil. But the evil wasn't destroyed. It was subdued. It was overridden. And that's why the Yidden had to run out of Mitzrayim, they had to escape Mitzrayim, because Mitzrayim still existed. The evil of Mitzrayim was still there. It was just subdued. That's why we had to run out, and it says, you know, that's why we have matzah. When Mashiach comes, the Navi says, "Ki lei b'menusa teilechem." The Navi says, "We're not running anywhere." Mashiach comes, and Mitzrayim, we're running. Ki b'chapazin, we're rushed. Mashiach comes, we're not running. Why aren't we running anywhere? There's nothing to run from, because bottom up, we've dealt with everything. We haven't overridden the evil. We've gotten rid of it. We've eradicated it, and the whole world becomes imbued with kedusha. And that is, you know, so again, this idea of Nisim, of miracles, is really emblematic of what the Baal Shem Tov was for. The Baal Shem Tov was about Gili Oyer, was about revelation and about inspiration. And we all need that revelation inspiration to get us started. In order to get started on your own Avodah, on Avodah B'Koyach Atzma, in order to have the Sarusa Dilatata, we need to be inspired there. The Baal Shem Tov was the inspiration. But what is supposed to follow the inspiration and the miracles is the Aveda which we do on our own. It's not about, so again, it's about ourselves, it's about the world. I know I'm making a little of a chant over here, but it's really all one idea. A miracle is overriding nature, and there's also overriding we're talking about the nature of the world, and there's also overriding our own personal nature. And in both of those cases, that's not the Tachlis HaKavana. The Tachlis HaKavana is that, you know, really, the best thing is that if we never need a miracle, wouldn't that be the best thing if we never need a miracle? That's really, by the way, what Mashiach is going to be. There's not going to be miracles when Mashiach comes. Think about it. If we need a miracle when Mashiach comes, then that's not Mashiach. That means there's a problem that we need a miracle for. You know, if Mashiach comes, it's about no more miracles. The world itself reaches perfection. And the same thing in our own lives, when we stop needing miracles, when we stop needing that inspiration, because we ourselves have learned, and we understand, and we feel, and it becomes our own avodah, that is our own personal geula. You know, in our own lives, we have, there's Yetzias Mitzrayim in our lives, which is we're supposed to do every single day. And then there's Kol Yimei Chayecha L'Havi L'Meis HaMashiach, which we say in the Haggadah. The Rebbe explains, what does it mean, Kol Yimei Chayecha L'Havi L'Meis HaMashiach? that it's not, in other words, beforehand in the Haggadah we have Kol Yemecha Yacham, that you have to mention Yetzias Mitzrayim every day, meaning that we have to accomplish Yetzias Mitzrayim every single day. And then another come along the Chachamim, and they say that Kol Yemecha Yacham Lahavi Lemeisan Hashiach, that it's not enough to have Yetzias Mitzrayim in our lives, we also have to have Mashiach in our lives. I'm not talking about Mashiach as in the grand scheme. I'm talking about in our own Aveda. What does Mashiach mean? Mashiach means when we are completely on board, on our own, Aveda B'Koyach Atzmai, that is really the Geula in our own life. And just to conclude this Nakuda, this idea, that in Lubavitch, we talk about Chai Elul as being the birthday of the Shtei HaMa'iris HaGadolim, the two great luminaries, Baal Shem Tov and the Alter Rebbe. I've never seen this stated anywhere, but I was thinking today, the two great luminaries, so what are they? They're the sun and the moon. No, so who's the sun, who's the moon? Alter Rebbe, the Baal Shem Tov. And it occurred to me that it would seem that the Baal Shem Tov is the sun, and the Alter Rebbe is the moon. What's the difference between the sun and the moon? The sun is very powerful. The sun is very overbearing, as we all, anyone who's outside today knew that, right? The sun is the mashpia. The relationship between the sun and the moon is that the sun is the mashpia, the giver, the benefactor, and the moon is the mekabel. The moon has no light of its own, it receives. So the sun represents the idea of giving, the moon represents the idea of receiving. Which one's greater? We're not going to get into who's greater, but the point is, they each have their own mila. On the one hand, in terms of strength, the sun is much stronger than the moon. But we know that even we identify with the moon. There's an advantage to the moon also. There's an advantage to the mekabel. Mekabel means, when the avodah is mitzad the mekabel, that means, the moon means it's about me. It's about the mekabel, the one who's receiving. It's not about the inspiration I receive from someone else. The moon represents the mekabel. And it's not an easy life. When you're mekabel, when you're working on your own, you have your ups and you have your downs, and the moon waxes and it wanes, and it goes and it complains to the Eibishter and says, "I have a terrible lot, and why did you make it to me? Why did you make me like this?" But at the end of the day, what the moon has, it internalizes, it becomes its own. And in terms of the derech of the Baal Shem Tov and the derech of the Alter Rebbe, perhaps it can be said that Baal Shem Tov was the derech of the sun. The emphasis was on the giver, the one who is the gili elokus, and the emphasis of the Alter Rebbe was on the mekabel, on the recipient, on us, on the avoid of the mekabel, on the avoid of the tachton, the one below, to make himself roi, to give off light. L'chaim, l'chaim l'vracha.
Rahamana di anaydi 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 anaydi
So how is all this connected to Rosh Hashanah? You look at Chassidus, the big question that surrounds Rosh Hashanah is its timing. Rosh Hashanah, we come to Shul, and we proclaim, Zeh Hayoyim Tchilas Masacha. This is the day of the beginning of your works. But the fact is that what is Rosh Hashanah? Rosh Hashanah is not the day when the world was created. Rosh Hashanah is the anniversary of the sixth day of creation, the day when Adam and Chava were created. What is the anniversary of the creation of the world? 25th of Elul. It's upcoming Thursday, which is barely a blip on the calendar. Anyone knows what Chafei Elul is? Anyone ever celebrated it? What's Chafei Elul? You think into it. On the first day of creation, the Eibishter created the cosmos, the universe, which anyone here knows a little science, probably better than me, knows how awesome and how incredible that is. Bria yesh mi'ayin. Something from nothing, which we can't even begin to fathom what that means, because we can't fathom what nothing means. We live in a world where everything is something. Whether it's a gas, or whether it's a solid, or whatever it is. The Eibishter took a bunch of nothing, I know that sounds silly, and he created the universe. And we don't commemorate that. Nothing happens on Chafei Elul. 6 days, 6 days later, the Eibishter creates two human beings, and that becomes a big deal. We make a Rosh Hashanah out of that. Doesn't it seemingly doesn't make sense? And Rosh Hashanah, as we know, it's not only human beings that are judged in Rosh Hashanah. You know, Yom Hadin. What? The same as Sanateke, the whole by, what? They're also the Malachim, and the whole by Elam, everything. Everything gets judged in Rosh Hashanah. So if it was only human beings that get judged, you say, okay, this is the anniversary of when you're created, so therefore we'll make it Rosh Hashanah for you. But it's Rosh Hashanah for the world. Chassidus explains that when Hashem created the world on Chafei Elul, the first time, it was the biggest act of chesed that Hashem ever did. greater than anything else. Why? What is the definition of chesed? The definition of chesed?
Giving.
Kindness?
No.
But not only, I can give, for example, if you work and your employer gives you a paycheck, is that chesed? No. Even if he gives you a very big paycheck. It's not chesed, right? That you earned it. So chesed is not defined as giving, but chesed is defined as undeserved giving. That's the definition of chesed. Otherwise, you can give, and that's called din. Midas ad-din, which we all are very scared of. But what does midas ad-din actually mean? Din means justice. And justice means that when you do something good, you get paid for it. When the Eibishter first created the world, it was the ultimate act of chesed. Why? Because we didn't deserve to be created. That kind of goes without saying, right? We did. How could we have earned to be created or deserved to be created if we weren't there? So it was the ultimate gesture. It's called kichafetz chesed. Who? When the Eibishter created the world, it was the ultimate gesture. There was absolutely nothing that elicited this act from the Eibishter. It was pure 100% the Eibishter's chesed. The Eibishter creates the world with his chesed. And then on the sixth day, he creates Adam and Chava. And he turns to Adam and Chava and says, no more. I mean, yes, there will be chesed here and there. The Eibishter still has chesed. But this, what I did once, not happening again. From now on, everything is in your hands. You want the world to be created? Earn it. Deserve it. And the very first day of creation, the Medrash tells us that Adam went and gathered all the animals and said, Beyu nishtachvu nechral afnei Hashem Eisenu. He went and bowed down to Hashem. And they were mekabel Hashem's malchus upon them. And that act, it was the symbolic passing of the baton on Rosh Hashanah. Hashem was saying, until now, I was doing everything, and now, it's your turn. And that's what happens every year on Rosh Hashanah. According to Kabbalah, it's a very interesting process. According to Kabbalah, on the night of Rosh Hashanah, as the new year departs, Rosh Hashanah, we know, is called, there's a big avodah called Binyan HaMalchus. What does Binyan HaMalchus mean? Kabbalah talks about it. That means when Chav Tes El departs, the night of Rosh Hashanah, the Eibishter loses interest in this world. Okay, I did it for a year. His desire, the Eibishter's Ratzon, obviously we're talking everything in words of what you have to add, Kaviyachon, but the Eibishter loses his Ratzon and his Tainug, his desire and his pleasure in this world. And every year again, it's up to us to reawaken the Eibishter's desire and the Eibishter's pleasure in this world. And this is done primarily by Tkiyas Shofar. But really it's throughout the davening. What is Rosh Hashanah all about? It's about the Eibishter's kingship. We turn to the Eibishter and we beg, and we plead, and we say, Maleich al kala elam kule bikvedecha. We beg the Eibishter to please be king over the world for another year. And when he's king over the world, that means he continues creating the world and he takes care of the world. Because all the world comes from Malchus, the Eibishter's Malchus, the Eibishter's kingship. And our tefillah is to the Eibishter. We turn to the Eibishter, it reaches its peak during Tkiyas Shofar, and we take out a shofar. And we blow the shofar, and the shofar is a cry. It's a simple cry, because as we know, the depth of our emotions, when we're feeling something very strongly, the depth of our emotions cannot be relayed in words. Words are useful sometimes, and sometimes they're useless. Anyone who's ever had a very deep emotion, whatever that emotion may be, whether it was happiness, whether it was pain, whether it was sadness, whether it was anger, you know that when you have a really deep emotion, words fail you. You can't express what you're feeling. And that is what the shofar is. When words fail us in our turning to the Eibishter and begging and asking him to be king for another year, we take out the shofar, we blow the shofar. And every year, when we do it properly, the Eibishter agrees once again to be the king over the world for another year. Oh, and by the way, if he's being the king over the world for another year, so it's time to make a judgment. What's going to be this year? Who's going to live? Who's going to die? Who's going to make money? Who's not going to make money? Who's going to be sick? But that's all really connected to the internal Kabbalistic understanding of what Rosh Hashanah is. Rosh Hashanah is about our being mekabel, the malchus of the Eibishter. And that's a mechanism which the Eibishter wants, because again, when the Eibishter created the world, he originally made that gesture. That was what he was doing for us. But the tachlis hakavana, why did the Eibishter create the world? Not because the Eibishter doesn't want chesed. I know that sounds strange, but really, Rashi says that. It's the very first Rashi in the Torah, right? What does it say? It says bereishis bara likim. So what does Rashi say? Why say Elikim? Because b'tchila, in the beginning, the Eibishter, when he created the world, what did he want? He wanted a world that was with Midas Adin. That's the Eibishter. He wants Midas Adin. He saw Nebach. We wouldn't be able to manage only with Midas Adin. So he added in some Rachamim. What kind of Eibishter is that? Why did he want to... What was his original intention? Why did he want to create a world that's Din? But what is Din? Din means that the Eibishter wants a world where we earn that which we get. Because when we earn that which we get, we appreciate it and we enjoy it and we don't feel like losers. In the words of Kabbalah, if we're getting gifts all the time, we're getting a free ride, it's called Nahama Diksufa. It's called bread of shame. It's like, you know, someone, if you don't have a job, you don't work, and you live off someone else, you don't feel good around that person. The Eibishter wanted, the ultimate chesed is that there shouldn't be chesed. But the Eibishter saw the world wouldn't be able to manage that way. So he had to put in chesed. But when Mashiach comes, what's going to happen? We know that the Arizal says that when Mashiach comes, the Halacha is going to be like Beis Shammai. Beis Shammai was about Gevurah, was about Din. Because when Mashiach comes, that's again, we're going to be on a level of Gevurah. We're going to be a level where we earn it all. So think about that for a second. Rosh Hashanah, we asked, why was Rosh Hashanah the way that the day the Adam was created? Because Taka, in the first year, when Hashem created the world, so Chafei Elul was the big deal. But now Chafei Elul was Taka, not a big deal. Why? Because the first time when they created the world was about him. And now it's about us. And when were we created? That's Aleph Tishrei. And Rosh Hashanah is about the Eibishter turning and saying, until now it was what I did, and now I'm giving it over to you. And something interesting. Chaf Hei Elul, the word Chaf, Chaf Hei spells the word Koi. Koi means about this, like this, something like of this sort. And Rosh Hashanah, we come to Shul and we say, Zeh Hayim Tchilas Masecha. The difference between Zeh and Koi. Rosh Hashanah is Zeh Hayim, and Chafei Elul is Koi. You know, Rashi talks about the difference between Moshe and all the Nevi'im. The call Nevi'im, the Snabu, Bekoi. All the Nevi'im, when they said Nevuah, they said Koi Amar Hashem, which means it wasn't so clear. Hashem said something like this. And Moshe was the one who said, Zeh Hadavar Hashativ Hashem, this. You know, this is something you point your finger at. The Gili Elokus that came about on Chaf Hei Elul, that comes about through the Eibishter's initiative, that's Koi. That's not so clear. It's not so crystal clear. The Gili Elokus that we generate through our Avoda on Rosh Hashanah, that's Zeh. That's a Gili Elokus we can actually, it's concrete and it's palpable and it's something we can touch with our finger. This is it. In general, Rosh Hashanah represents the transition. It talks about how there's the 6 months starting from Nisan, which are miracle months, as the name Nisan implies. And Nisan is a month of miracles. And then you have the summer months, which the sun is shining, Gili Elokus, Yom Tovim, and Tishrei, begins the 6 months of Aveda Sa'adam, our work. It's represented also by Dirtin Du and rain, as explained. What's the connection between the first thing we spoke about and the second thing, between Tishrei and between Rosh Hashanah and the miracles? It's really the same thing. Saying the same thing using different words. It's all about Avedas, Avedas Atachten. It's all about our Aveda. Rosh Hashanah is about our Aveda. It's what they were saying. I gave you your inspiration. I gave you the head start. I created a world for you. And now it's your turn to do the work. And that's really also the nekuda of Chassidus Chabad is all about. It's about Avedas, Avedas Hamata. And it's about our own Aveda doing what has to be done. Being self-generated engines. That's what we have to be. We have to change ourselves, not just override ourselves, but change ourselves and do that Aveda. And what's interesting is that on the Rosh Hashanah, you know, something we don't really think about that much. Rosh Hashanah, we know, is the anniversary of Adam and Chava were created. What else happened on Rosh Hashanah? On that day they were created. What? They were punished because Chate Tzadas. You know, one last time you thought about that. Rosh Hashanah was the Chet Eitz Hadas. And what was the punishment they got? They were exiled from Gan Eden. True. And what else? Can't hear you. They had to do work. You guys are missing one of the main things. If not... They're going to die. Very good. The Eibishter told Adam and Chava that the day when they eat Eitz Hadas, they're going to die. It doesn't mean that they're going to die on that day, but that means on the day when they eat from the Eitz Hadas, they become mortal creatures. They become creatures that die. For a short while, that went away. Later, by Mount Terah, then by Chet Ha'Egel, came back. Which is interesting, because that means to tell us that death, which we think is like natural to the human condition, it's not. It's actually a glitch in the system. Originally, when we were created, we're going to live forever. Chayim Nitzchim. But because Adam and Chava messed up, which granted that was also part of the plan, but because Adam and Chava messed up, so therefore, we have death. And when Mashiach comes, and when we correct that, so Taka, there will be Bila HaMavis LaNetzach, as Yeshaya says, that the Taka, there won't be death anymore. What is death? Why did death result from Chet Eitz Hadas? What happened? You know, in Torah, we don't believe, it's not, the rewards and punishments in the Torah, it's not like you go and you do your job, and you get money. What? I understand. But now when Mashiach comes. And that wasn't the way it was supposed to be when we were created. Right? That even Mashiach comes. Okay, the Rambam says that also. The Machlok is the Rambam and the Ramban, and the Bechla, the Mekubal, and Paskin according to the Ramban, which is that there will be, after Mashiach comes, we chayim nitzchim. But it's a Machlok is the Rambam and the Ramban. Back upon him, even if Mashiach will die, there's no question that Tchias HaMeisim is going to happen, and there's going to be a time when there's also no question that originally, right, that the original plan was that we're living forever. What happened by Chet Eitz Hadas? You know, again, we go to work, we have a job, and then you get a paycheck. The paycheck isn't created by your work, it's by the way, right? You do something wrong, you get punished. The rewards and the punishments that in this world are mostly or in large part, they're extrinsic. They're not directly caused by that which we did. In Torah, however, rewards and punishments are all natural. That's what the Shalah says. That the rewards and punishments are all natural consequences. What happened by Chet Eitz Hadas that brought about Misa? And the explanation is that before Chet Eitz Hadas, before I can speak about the Sfarna, the Ramban, before Chet Eitz Hadas, the guf was transparent to the neshama. Imagine you're looking out of a window and you're seeing a beautiful painting over there, mountain or something. You don't notice the window. That's the way the guf was before Chet Eitz Hadas. The guf wasn't noticeable. The guf was a tool of the neshama. Every single one of the limbs of the body was holy, and the mouth was to eat in order to serve Hashem, and the ears was able to hear the shiurim and Torah to serve Hashem. The nose was for besamim, and every single limb. And there was no schism, there was no discrepancy, there was no divide between the desires of the neshama and the desires of the guf, because there were no desires of the guf, that didn't exist. And that's why they were naked and it wasn't an issue. Because the whole reason that you have to cover up certain parts of the body is when those parts of the body are disassociated from the neshama, from holiness. And when those parts of the body represent selfishness and selfish desires and egocentric desires. But before Chet Eitz Hadas, when everything was transparent to the neshama, so as the Sfarna says, there's no difference between the reproductive organs and the nose and the mouth and the face. Everything was there to serve Hashem. Chet Eitz Hadas introduced Eitz Hadas Toivara. Das means intimacy, connection. Eitz Hadas Toivara means that we became connected with Ra. What does Ra mean? Ra means selfishness. Suddenly the guf and the neshama have different agendas. The neshama wants to serve the Eibishter. The neshama wants to serve God. The guf doesn't want to. And that's embarrassing, by the way, sometimes. You have to cover it up. Clothing. The selfishness is embarrassing, especially when it's in its extreme and base ways. So how do we rectify that? We're heading to a time when Mashiach comes and only be lahamavus l'on netzach, and there won't be any more death. How do we do that? How do we rectify that? We have to heal the divide between the guf and the neshama. We have to make that the guf once again should be transparent to the neshama. We can't do that by breaking the guf. We can't do that by ignoring the guf. You know, the Baal Shem Tov says, the famous Torah of the Baal Shem Tov, Kisira Chameir Senacha. The Baal Shem Tov was against the idea of, you know, fasting and segufim and all these things. We have to work with the guf. What does that mean to work with the guf? What does that mean? How do we get the guf and the neshama to be in sync with each other? The guf, we're not talking about the fingers, we're not talking about the physical flesh and sinews and blood. What is the guf? The guf refers to the desires of the guf. What does the guf want? What does it understand? What does it feel? How do we get that the desires of the guf, the mind, the heart, should be brought in and should become one with the neshama? And that's everything, and that's the same thing that we're talking about up until this point. It all comes down, beginning with the mind, learning and understanding. And when your mind understands, when your mind begins, by way of example, there are two ways to have Avos Yisrael. One way to have Avos Yisrael is, my friend annoys me to no end. I don't like his personality. His voice grates on my nerves. But because the Torah says, V'yahavta l'rayacha kamecha, every time I see him, I smile. I'm nice to him. I'm kind to him. This is a perfect example of the guf and the neshama not being in sync. Now, is that better than every time I see him, me turning the other way or calling him a name? Definitely, there's no question. As I mentioned earlier, the first part of the Aveda is to override the guf. That's step number one. That's the step of the Baal Shem Tov. But my neshama, what is real Avos Yisrael? Real Avos Yisrael is, I understand what another Yid is. I understand what a neshama is. So when I look at the other Yid, I feel nothing but kindness and love and appreciation and respect, etc. That's the guf and the neshama being in sync with each other. And the only way that the guf and the neshama can become in sync, that when I'm acting the way the Torah wants me to act, it's not despite my guf, but bringing my guf along for the ride, is if it starts in the head. It starts with learning. It starts with understanding. It starts with changing my perspective. So when we're talking about Tchias HaMeisim and the Avodah that brings us to Tchias HaMeisim, which is really connected to Rosh Hashanah, because Tchias HaMeisim is the rectification, again, of Chet Yetzadas, which happened on Rosh Hashanah. We keep on going back in circles and we keep on coming back to the same Nekudah. Which is Aveda again, Aveda Mitzad the Tachton. And this Aveda Mitzad the Tachton, where does it begin? It begins in the mind. From the mind, it goes to the heart. From the heart, it goes into Machshava Dibur Ma'aseh. And before we conclude, I just want to say one story. There was a chassid, I forget his name. And he lived in Nikolaev. Nikolaev is the city where the Rebbe was born. We're talking a little more than 100 years ago. Anshul something. Anshul Aronovich, I think his name was, if I remember correctly. And he took upon himself the formidable task of reprinting the Likutei Torah. Likutei Torah is a sefer of Mamarim. They were right over there. The Marim said by the Alter Rebbe, printed by the Tzemach Tzedek, his grandson. And the previous printings was full of typos. And he took it upon himself to reprint it and to fix the typos. He fixed 3,000 typos in Likutei Torah. Imagine that, 3,000. How many pages are there in Likutei Torah? We're talking probably what? 300 pages? We're talking about 10 typos per page, right? He went and he showed the new product, the new sefer that he printed, to the Rebbe Rashab. Rebbe Rashab was very happy. On his way home, he went and he stopped by in the city of Chernigov. In the city of Chernigov, there was a famous chassid, older chassid, much older than the Rebbe Rashab. His name was Reb David Tzvi Chen, known as the Radatz Chen, or by chassidim known affectionately as Hirschel Chernigover. He used to speak in learning with the Tzemach Tzedek. That's the grandfather of the Rebbe Rashab. He was a big Rav. And he showed him the Likutei Torah, and he saw that he wasn't very happy with it. This Reb Anshul saw that he wasn't very happy with it. And he couldn't understand. Why aren't you happy with it? I fixed all these mistakes. I reprinted it. So he says, I'll tell you. So what do you think chassidus is? So chassidus is what? Something, it's like something you learn, I understand it, and I move on in life. He says, it used to be, chassid sat down to learn the Kotei Torah, but it's full of typos, he couldn't understand what's going on. So he had to sit and work very, very hard to understand it. So it took him a long time to learn the Maamar. What did you accomplish? You fixed all the typos, and now the chassid, instead of sitting 3 hours in the Maamar, he's going to finish it in a half an hour and go off to work. He's thinking about the Eberster for 2.5 hours less because of you. Now, this doesn't mean that we should start introducing typos in the books. By the way, I had an interesting experience. Mamish 2 weeks ago, something of this sort. I'm working on a course now for JLI, and it's about the afterlife. So someone pointed out to me, there's a Lakuti Deborim from the Friedrich Rebbe, Sikha from the Friedrich Rebbe, where he talks about, it's interesting Sikha, he talks about there was a chassid whose name was Reb Hendel. Reb Hendel, Chanoich Hendel Kugel. You teach JLI? No, you used to? You didn't? I shouldn't pay attention to you. Okay. He says, it talks there, that the Rebbe Rashab is talking about how, you know that it says that Mishpat Rishayim B'Gehenim Rishayim, the most during Gehenim is 12 months. He's talking about that. This Reb Hendel, he only smelled Gehenim and he went straight to Gehen Eden. In other words, he's a very holy person. But he goes on and says like this, that the average person spends in Gehenim 19 manatim. 19 months. Like, where is this from? 19 months. Gehenim. The Mishnah in Adias says that that the maximum is, what? It's 12 months. And also the Gemara in Shabbos, by the story of Shimon Bar Yochai, 12 months. Where's the 19 months from? So I have Eitzer HaChachma, right? So I'm busy looking all over the place. Can't find anything. He goes, the average is 19 months, and then if you're Shemir Torah Mitzvahs, then you usually run 7-8 months, whatever. He goes the whole say there. So finally, after like at least 2 hours looking into this, so I think to myself, you know what, maybe the Sikha is printed elsewhere, and maybe wherever we're the other place it is, maybe because sometimes the Rebbe puts footnotes, maybe the Rebbe explains something. So I looked at Sikha and Tavshin Beis. So I open up the Sefer Sikha's Tavshin Beis. The Sikha is printed there. And there it says, the average neshama is in Gehenna 9-10 manatim. In other words, 9-10 months, 9 to 10 months, instead of 9, and the typo over there, because the Rebbe said typo, you can look at the Rebbe, because the Rebbe said typo, it says 9, that's one word, nun, yud, yud, nun, nun, kfufa, tzadik, ayin. So this typo led me to research this topic for 2 hours. So mamish, what the Adats was saying, I experienced it, you know, that because of this typo, so I familiarized myself with the topic much more, because I had to figure out what's going on. Because chassidus is not something they say, I learn a mimer, and okay, I move on, I learned it, I know it. Okay, so I finished that mimer, I put it back. Yeah, it's very important. We're talking here about chassidus being a philosophy, and chassidus teaches us how to think, but it's also about saturation. You know, if you're a genius and you could learn chvis, a whole hemshach in 2 hours, it's not the point. It's not only about understanding, figuring it out. It's about how much time is my mind spending thinking about the Eibishter. You know why? Because we're in a world where everything that we learn in chassidus, you go out in the street and the opposite is true. To the eyes. You learn chassidus. You know, the joke is said about this chassid who's sitting in his room all night and he's meditating on Enet Movadiah. There's nothing other than the Eibishter. And then he wakes up in the morning. Now he wakes up after he finishes meditating the whole night. He opens the door. He goes outside and he bangs his nose right into the wall. It's right there. He's like, there's nothing about the Eibishter and the wall. You learn about how you can learn chassidus, and you learn about Ashgacha Pratis, you learn about the Eibishter and Achdus Hashem, and about the Ikaris Torah Mitzvahs. Now everything else is garnished, and you walk out into a world where everything else, the opposite, the Hanachas HaElam, the way the world looks at the opposite. It takes more than a 5 minute inculcation of Chassidus to combat 23 hours and 55 minutes of opposition to Chassidus. And that's what Reb David Tzvichin was saying. When he was saying, you know, what did you do by fixing the typos? If we want Chassidus to have an effect on us, so yeah, we have to learn and we have to understand, not just be inspired. Inspiration is an awful word. It really is. In other words, if we always in a state of inspiration, it's a problem. We need to move beyond. Inspiration means there's me and what I'm being inspired to do. No, we need to learn. We need to become part of who we are, part of our personality, part of the way we see things, part of the way we feel about things. And it has to be literally in other words, time every day or several times a week, significant time spent saturating the mind and thinking about the Eibishter. And when we do that, we can talk to have, you know, an impact that we arm ourselves, we protect ourselves, that then we're able to go out into the world and still be thinking about the Eibishter and Achdus Hashem because of the amount of time that we spent on that. And it's not about necessarily gaining a library of knowledge in your mind. My brother, maybe some of you here heard about a mashpia, his name was Jermendel Futterfass, passed away around 25 years ago. So my brother was in yeshiva in Kfar Chabad. So he once went, there was a mimer that he was learning, a mimer from the Rebbe Rashab, and he had a difficulty in understanding. So he went over to Mendel, and he asked him a question on the mimer, and Mendel, and his answer was basically pretty much repeating the mimer verbatim, word for word. So my brother asked him if he had just learned this mimer. He said no. He said, in fact, I haven't learned this mimer in 70 years. Probably gives him a look. 70 years, and he was literally repeating the words of the mimer about that. Said, yeah, he says, when you learn a mimer more than 300 times, it becomes etched within you. Brother said, 300 times? He said, yeah, even he was a bacher in yeshiva. So he once by Fabrangin, and the mashpia said that the bacherim should pick one mimer, and for a full year, every day before davening, they should learn that mimer. And this mimer, which he was the mimer that he had chosen, so for a full year, which is more than 300 times, he sat and he learned this mimer every morning. And then it becomes etched. You think, what's the point? He may as well learn different mimer, learn 300 mimer. It's about saturation, it's about the amount of time that you spend thinking about the Eibishter every single day. So, I think, we'll see L'chaim. And as a new year approaches us, Baleinu L'Teva, we should all seek to increase our own avoda, getting our neshamas in sync with our guf. Sorry, the opposite way. Getting our gufing to be in sync with our neshama, that we should be a person, there's achdus within us. And that whatever we do, we should be fully in it. When we do Torah mitzvahs, we should be there with our minds and with our heart. Mashav de Bermaisa. And we should all have a good Gibensh year. Chaim.